honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Captivating. Definitely so. But still impermanent. Danger. A denial. A boil. A cancer. Something that should be seen as it rightly is. A suffering. As not me, not mine. Not something to be kept. Not something I can rely upon. Thank you.
Friends, what are the four foundations of awareness? One, seeing the body as a full frame, while always acutely alert and clearly comprehending, thus removing any lust, urge, envy, frustration, and discontent rooted in this world. The intelligent bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all bodies as alien frames of filthy and foul form, as something bound to emerge, decay and vanish, neither as me, mine, nor belonging to me, nor as what I am, nor as a manifested representation of a myself, neither as lasting, stable, or safety, neither as pleasant beauty or pride. That is seeing the body as a full frame. Two, the second factor of the four foundations of awareness is regarding any feeling as an annoying reaction. The intelligent bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all feeling as a remote and ever-recurring reactivity, as something bound to arise, decay and fade away, not as mine, felt by me, nor belong to me, nor as what I am, nor as something felt by my very self, neither as lasting, stable, safe, neither as ever pleasure or lasting bliss. That is regarding any feeling as an annoying reaction. The third factor, the third foundation of awareness is noticing mind just as passing moods. The intelligent bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all mind as a habituated set of bizarre mentalities of a weird nature that appears, dwindles, flutters and flickers. He regards none of these moods as something that I am, nor as a part of a me, nor as making up of my ego or myself. He regards neither with these passing moods, as lasting, stable, or ever same. He does not see them as fascinating, nor as a soul or a personality. The fourth foundation of awareness is knowing all phenomena only as momentary appearances, only as passing mental states, Dhamma. The intelligent bhikkhu keeps contemplating and regarding any and all phenomena only as mentally constructed appearances of momentary manifestation, always ending right there where they emerged. These appearances does not regard as mine, belong to me, or as self, or as substance, or as real. Does not regard these appearances, these phenomena, these manifestations as something stable or lasting, or as existent, or as enduring, substantial, material, absolute, or even authentic. That is knowing all phenomena only as momentary mental appearances or representations. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 101, and it is about impermanence, anicca, transience, and it is entitled Urgency versus Complacency. It is prompted by a elderly gentleman, and as you see, we're in a Danish forest today. So the forest settings remains, but the forest has changed character a little bit. It is prompted by an elderly gentleman who is taking care of his 84-year-old lady and wife who has dementia, and who asked me to make a video on how actually this impermanence spells or induces or results in suffering, dukkha, inevitable. So this will be it's a very common subject actually, often overlooked and neglected, because this impermanence is universal. But because of this apparent continuity, this apparent constancy, then is often forgot and neglected. To those who post questions, then I like to say, those who have posed questions higher than number 290, please resend them to my email, because I lost my laptop and it crashed, and I lost the file that contained all the new questions. So please resend all questions with bigger numbers than 290. And now we will slowly go up to the large oak tree, which is up here on the top. This is in the middle part of Denmark. It's called Zealand, and it's close to where my father lives. A small update on my father, which has bearing on anicca, is that he is actually okay. He had some symptoms from his cancer when I arrived, but now he's definitely doing better. However, the speed of his decay, this seems to be increasing. One manifestation was that In 2 weeks, he lost 2 teeth that spontaneously fell out of his mouth. And this, of course, is a, if anything is, a very acute witness of impermanence. However, since this impermanence is universal, one should note that this body also, has not gone beyond aging, sickness, and death. This body also will lose all its teeth. This body also will become gray and grow old. But first, we go up to the tree and install the camera. Regarding this impermanence, we tend to forget it because there is this apparent continuity. It seems that though we can see there is change, because there is this continuity, it seems that everything is connected in time, then we tend to believe that it is constant. And then imminent in this constancy, which is a fallacy and an illusion, because there is change, then we think also we can keep it. And this is very much against the Buddhist teaching, which teaches this impermanence, this universal impermanence. As soon as you start to think that health and youth and social status and job and bodily strength and beauty, this is constant, then you think I can keep it. So it's a false perception of constancy that leads to this tenacious clinging to these objects, because one thinks and have thought for a long time, I can't keep it. I can't keep my happiness coming from this youth, from this health, from this beauty, from this social safety, which is an illusion. The Buddha, he once said, anicca anupassanam paventu nicca sanam pacciati. When developing the contemplation of impermanence, anicca, one gradually, little by little, overcomes the false perception of permanence. Gradually, little by little, because one should look at this impermanence long and long again and again. Especially when hit by impermanence, that is, there is an abrupt change inducing some kind of frustration or suffering. Then one should again note impermanence. There's two good sides of impermanence. One of them is that bad states also pass by. It's not only a good states that is lost by becoming otherwise. It is also bad states that is turned into neutral states or good states, whether internal, external, physical or mental, that changes, that cannot last, that is not permanent. And so this is the one thing that is positive with the phenomena of impermanence. The other thing is that it is this impermanence-induced suffering that drives faith, satta, and thereby faith developing gradually into confidence, and thereby training energy and awareness and concentration and the last ability, spiritual ability, panya, understanding or wisdom. Then one gets direct experience with this phenomena of the noble life. And thereby one gains conviction. Now one is beyond what is in the books or what the monk says or what other disciples says. Now one can confirm it by direct experience. So this is very positive that there is this aspect of a positive aspect of impermanence-induced suffering. Furthermore, he said, when Ananda, the
is the experience of impermanence, inconstancy, and transience. How it's developed? Yeah, when a bhikkhu have gone to a forest, to the foot of a tree, or to an empty place reflects us, all form is inconstant. Internal form, the body. External form, the world. All mental construction is transient. All experience is impermanent. All feeling is fleeting. And all consciousness is momentary. It is in this way that there remains an understanding of impermanence and the inconstancy and transience of these five clusters of clinging. These five clusters of clinging are dukkha, are suffering. What is the five clusters of clinging? This is clinging to form, internal as well as external. Clinging to feeling, vedana. Clinging to perception, or experience, sanya. Clinging to mental construction, sankara. And clinging to consciousness. So this is something that that as soon as this craving for it, because one thinks one can keep it and thereby gain happiness by it, then there will also be clinging. And as soon as there's clinging to it, then there will be suffering. Why so? Because clinging is a solidified form of craving. And craving always causes suffering. He furthermore said, because there's no lasting matter or materiality, no lasting form whatsoever. There's no lasting feeling whatsoever. There's no lasting perception whatsoever. There's no lasting mental construction, thought, idea, or intention whatsoever. There's no lasting consciousness or awareness of anything whatsoever. There's no permanent, everlasting, eternal thing that is not subject to change, not transient, not decaying, not vanishing, that will last as long as eternity. Samyutta Nikaya 22:96. So nothing of these five clusters of clinging, which is an all-encompassing classification, whether internal or external, past, present, or future, is lasting. And therefore one cannot trust it. It is not safety. It is not something one can keep. It is not something one can rely upon. And therefore one should have a sense of urgency, samvega, the opposite of complacency, where one imminently and often subconsciously trust, I can keep this body, I can regain this pleasant feeling, I scream, you scream, we all scream for ice cream. I can regain my consciousness tomorrow when I wake up. Yes, true, but you cannot keep it still. So it is always a catch-22. If one gets addicted to it, one has to pay with frustration when it's lost by becoming otherwise. He also said, all formations, all constructions are impermanent, transient, vanishing. Majjhima Nikaya 35. Whatever can arise and emerge, that also surely will cease. Majjhima Nikaya 56. So you can say it is imminent, inherent in whatever can come into being, that since it can come into being, since it can emerge, since it can arise, caused by conditions, then when one of these conditions or all of them disappear, then the phenomena will also disappear. So this is the main theme of conditioned arising, paticca-samuppada. That when this is, that is also. When this ceases, that ceases also. When this come into being, that's come into being. When this ceases to be, that also ceases to be. So this means that if one cannot break this phenomena for conditioned things. The only thing that is not conditioned, not caused by anything, is nirvana, the deathless element, which thereby becomes the only alternative to buzzing around in samsara, clutching onto this impermanent happiness, and then clutching onto another impermanent happiness when this disappears. And then jumping from tree to tree, trying to regain this ephemeral, transient, vanishing happiness that comes from sense pleasure, or comes from various kinds of becoming, or comes from various kinds of non-becoming. One cannot easily observe the characteristic of impermanence because it is it's concealed and obscured by this apparent continuity. So mind, because it looks more or less the same, the monk looks more or less the same, the tree looks more or less the same. There is change to see, but it's easily forgot because the general characteristics is the same. The robe is still red. So one says, ah, this is the same monk as before. This is the same tree as before. Then one conceives, ferments, that all psychophysical phenomena out there, that they are constant and they are existing permanently. And therefore, one, it makes sense to invest in them because one can keep them and thereby gain happiness from them. That is lasting happiness. But this is wrong. It is coming from each other. It's a perpetual sequence of blinking moments, physical, psychical moments that blinks in, that is one leading to the next one, leading to the next one, leading to the next one, one conditioning the next one to arise. But it's not continuity, it is contiguity, that is discrete states. The Blessed Buddha, he also once said, Anuccat passanam bhavento nityasannam bhajati. By developing the contemplation of impermanence, one overcomes the perception of permanence, the false perception of permanence. And in Anguttara Nikaya 5.57, he says, there are these five facts that one should reflect upon often, whether one is a woman or a man, lay or a Dane, which five? I'm subject to aging, have not gone beyond aging. This is the first fact one should reflect upon other, whether woman or man, lay or ordained. I'm subject to sickness, have not gone beyond sickness. This is the second fact. I'm subject to death, have not gone beyond death. I'll grow different and separate from all that is dear and attractive to me. This is the third. I'm owner of my actions, here to my actions, born of my actions, related to my actions, have my actions, my karma, as arbitrator. Whatever I do for good or for bad, for that I will is be for always the owner, inheritor, and debtor. These are the five facts that one should reflect upon often, whether one is a man or woman, lay or ordained. That is, this body is subject to aging, sickness, and death. And this so-called me, this so-called self or individuality, we can say, individual stream of consciousness connected with a physical body, this will experience the results of any actions, intentional actions that it performs. So similarly with, this is regarding all internal, also all external, the eye, the forms, the colors, a visual consciousness, eye consciousness, and whatever feeling, whether pleasant feeling or painful feeling or neutral feeling, this visual consciousness together with the eye and the form, also called visual contact, eye contact, arise from that, that is also impermanent. So all visual forms, all which can be seen, is thereby suffering if one clings to it and is unaware of it and taking delight in it, thereby comes to cling to it because it's addictive. Yeah, why so? Because one cannot keep these captivating moments of visual stimulation. Think of going into a cinema and see an action movie or something like that, which is very, very captivating, designed to it, but it's gone immediately. So it cannot be kept. And it's not even real. So since it's passing, then it's disappointing if one expects it to be both real and lasting. And this one tends to do if one thinks, ah, this is permanent, this is lasting, I can regain it. And so also with all other things that can be sensed, anything that can be smelled, heard, tasted, touched, or all ideas and mental states, all these constructed formations are impermanent. So where whatever is subject to emergence, that is also subject to ceasing, nirodha. And so these phenomena, they seem to be real and they seem to be here, they are only here for one moment. So they arise and fall away, they come and go, they emerge and vanish on all time scales, from moment to moment, from plank moment to plank moment, from second to second, from minute to minute, from hour to hour, from day to day, from month to month, from year to year, from life to life, from universe to universe. It is a kind of, as soon as one starts to say, often subconsciously, being unaware of it, ah, this is permanent, this is lasting, this is something I can trust, this is something I can rely upon, this is an apparent safety, it's an island where I can stand, then one is creating, self-creating, by expecting it to last. One is self-creating one's own suffering, because this samsara, all in this samsara, whether internal or external, is unstable. Yeah, what is the purpose of life, conscious life, in the first place? Yeah, that is to regain and attain lasting happiness. And can this be found in the world? Apparently not. Why so? Because this anicca, this impermanence, this transience, this passing by, this coming and going, this is universal, it's absolute. There's no phenomena, no construction, no thing in samsara that is lasting. And therefore, it prevents that one can keep anything in this world. It leaves only one alternative, that is nibbana, which is outside samsara, and which therefore one should seek with great urgency, samvega, not falling again and again, thousands of lives after each other, falling into complacency of saying, ah, okay, I could rely upon it yesterday, then I can also rely upon it today, because this is not the case. That is this catch 22. As soon as you take delight in sense pleasures, or in forms of becoming, or in forms of not becoming. What do I mean by sense pleasures? It's all that can be seen, heard, smelled, tasted, touched, or mental states that can be attained. And what is becoming? This is becoming rich, famous, young, reborn, getting a new job, all kinds of new states that one can create or conditioned. What is not becoming? It is craving for not becoming dead, sick, insignificant, disrespected, and all dislike states. But because one cannot control samsara, then there is this catch 22, that the moment you take delight in this ephemeral, self-driving, conditioned phenomena, then there will be clinging to them because of addiction and habituation. And as soon as there is clinging, there has also been craving, because craving is the cause of clinging. Clinging is a solidified, cementified form of craving, wanting the phenomena, and then clinging to it, even sometimes even before you get it. So in any form of sense pleasure and any form of becoming, then this taking delight in it is caused by craving. And this craving always spell suffering, as the second noble truth is, says, that craving is the cause of all suffering. Craving towards the phenomena, the pleasant phenomena, and craving away from the painful phenomena. The Buddha often pointed out that all that is constructed, that is conditioned, is impermanent by saying, sabbasankara anicca, all constructions are impermanent. And this is simply from the fact that they are put together of other phenomena, of other causalities. So for creating a tree, there should be a seed, some earth, some light, some water, some fertilizer. And then if these phenomena are there, then the phenomena tree arise. But as soon as some of the phenomena are not there, then just one of them, for example water, then eventually the tree will go out of existence, it will dry out and die. So this means that it is kind of like hinged, any conditioned phenomena is hinged on all the participating causes. And this is a very fragile situation, of course, because all of these causes that create a tree, they are also impermanent. They are also impermanent. Impermanent are all component things. They arise and cease, that is their very nature. They come into being and pass away. Release from them is supreme bliss, did he say. Dikha Nikaya number 16. He was once asked the Buddha, what is the world? And then he answered, the eye disintegrates, form disintegrate, consciousness disintegrate, all contact, all feeling, all organs, all bodies, all sensation disintegrate. The intellect disintegrates, ideas disintegrate, the mind disintegrate. Insofar as it disintegrates, it falls apart. Insofar as it disintegrates, insofar as it falls apart, it is the world. So this is an interesting, from Samyutta Nikaya 35:82. It's an interesting definition of the world, of samsara. Insofar as it disintegrates, it is the world. Another place he points out, perception of inconstancy, impermanence, when developed and pursued, is of great fruit, of great benefit, of great advantage. It gains a footing in the deathless and has the deathless as its final end. And what is the perception of inconstancy? There is a case where a monk, having gone to the wilderness, to the shade of a tree, or to an empty building, reflects thus, all form is inconstant, all feeling is inconstant, all perception is inconstant. All fabrication is inconstant. All consciousness is inconstant. Thus, he remains focused on inconstancy, on impermanence, on transience. With regard to the five clusters of clinging, the khandhas, this ananda is called the perception of impermanence. Anicca, Anguttara Nikaya 7:46. So, when one continually notes a breakup, not only the coming into being of phenomena, but also the going out of existence of phenomena. Like I now have the chance to see my father decay when his teeth fall out. And this morning he went into bath. Then I saw his naked body for the first time for many years. And then I could see considerable decay compared to the last time I saw it completely naked 20 years ago. And so also I will look at my own body falling apart. This looking at one's own body in the mirror, and instead of falling in love with it, it induces advantage because this contemplation of dissolution, that things fall apart, this brings 8 advantages into being, is said. It eliminates the false view of permanence and eternal rebecoming. So the false view of permanence is a false view because there is no permanence of anything, anywhere, except Nibbana. 2, it let go of attachment to life itself and any form of being in existence. So this attachment, this clinging, tenacious clinging, which inherently induce panic and fear of losing, because of course mind knows this will disappear. It has tried it many times before. will disappear like sand between the fingers. Like water, you're trying to run with water on the beach, but it's impossible, it is lost. Still one can try, huh? But it's very frustrating because it's always lost. It induces constant and continuous improvement of the mental release. So by gradually slicing off bit by bit this clinging and thereby this craving for life itself, craving for life, for sense pleasure, and for becoming and for non-becoming, then the attachment, the clinging to life inducing this suffering goes down. It is induced the advantage of victory both over any attraction and any aversion. So you do not have attraction towards sense pleasure, towards becoming and towards non-becoming, nor any aversion against non-becoming, about passing out of existence, about becoming old, about becoming stupid, and it leads to a purified livelihood and morality. It induces patience and gentleness and freedom from anxiety, absence of fear is number 8. It is clear, of course, that when you don't cling to life, you're not afraid of losing life. If you're not afraid of losing life, as we know it, samsaric life, because you perceive it as suffering, because it's impermanent, then you become fearless, because there's nothing worse than dying. This is the deepest fear we have. So it induces fearlessness to note, to perceive, to look at and notice this impermanence instead of looking away from it. The ancient elders, say, remarked on realizing that these 8 perfect qualities, one comprehends the frail constructions fully, continually noting their breakup in order to swiftly attain the deathless state of bliss, as urgent as a sage with a burning turban. Samyutta Nikaya 56:34. So this is what they recommend. It is to say that if you have, let's say, a burning hat or burning turban on, or there's fire in your hair, the same urgency as one should feel there. Let's say you have fire in your hair because somebody put gasoline in your hair or on your hat or on your turban and then put fire to it. Then you would be very urgent to put this fire out. So the same fire one should, of craving for existence, for sense pleasure, craving for becoming and craving for non-becoming, this one should have a great sense of urgency of putting out. Because anytime, anywhere, and for everybody, these observable facts are: all states will pass, all things will vanish, all formations are unstable, all mountains crumble into nothing, all memories are lost like tears in rain, nothing remains static without change, all buildings and homes collapse into dust, all phenomena are of nature to break up, all moments momentarily cease never to return, all universes implode into pointless singularity, all phenomena are momentary and thus temporary, all bodies grow old, including this one and that one. It grow old, decrepit, fall, and finally rotten. All beings grow old, sick, ugly, smelling, and die. All worldly happiness and pleasure changes and is lost. All forms of form will decay, deteriorate, and fall apart. All constructions, all conditioned phenomena, whether physical or mental, internal or external, past, present, or future, arise and cease. Everything that emerges will by nature also come to an end. There's no lasting permanence whatsoever anywhere except Nirvana. So let this be the end mantra. Everything that arises will also cease. Everything that emerges will also vanish. Any clinging, attachment, reliance on these ephemeral formations, whether internal or external, past, present or future, induces suffering because of this inherent impermanence. You can say it is thus not because of the impermanence itself that there is suffering. It is because of the clinging and craving to it. But these two phenomena are connected because it is because of not seeing the impermanence that one thinks it is worth clinging to and craving to. If one sees impermanence, one sees that this doesn't last, then one stops craving for it. One stops relying on it. One stops clinging to this. This is mental release. This is approaching Nirvana gradually. Thanks for your advantageous attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thanks to all Dayakas, supporters, and donors, especially those who give regular donations, which is still needed, especially here in Denmark where the prices are very high. Subscribing is to this YouTube channel is your ticket to Nirvana. If one wants to support these videos, then one can go to whatbuddhasaid.net, and there's a click donation or click regular donation, and then one can also do it on Patreon, Patreon, and search for Samahita, Samahita. Many thank you in advance. Please email new questions to me, bantesamahita@gmail.com. And again, those who have emailed the questions before, 290. After 290, this is 291, 292. Please resend your questions. Thank you for today on Dhamma on Air number 101, under the tree in Denmark, noting the impermanence of the rustling leaves and the wind gently passing around the old aging tree being eaten up by a fungus. We only have to say Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. Thank you, and have a nice and noble day.
Apropos Nietzsche, as you see, this tree behind me is definitely strongly going out of existence. It's definitely impermanent.
Thank you for your clever attention, advantageous consideration, and kind contribution. Thank you to the food givers, the recent food givers, those who make the wheels turn around and the videos keep coming by a regular donation, and also to those who supported the meditation hall. Thank you. And may you indeed have a nice, noble, and beautiful day. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Sammahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.